Hello, everybody. My name is Dan Libby, class of 1982, Columbia School of Engineering, class of 1984, and a proud parent of class of 2018, just recently learned. And it's great to have everyone here today. Let me just introduce myself a little bit more. I'm on the CAA board and also have been a part of the Alumni Career Services Task Force since it was formed a few years ago. And I just think that the work that they've been doing, Lindsay and others on that task force, has been really well received by our alumni. And I think this is a really an example of a great service that we're providing to our alumni. And I hope you will take advantage of more of these networking events that they put on, because I think there's I think they put a lot of thought and effort into it. And if you have suggestions on how to improve the services that they're doing for career services for alumni, please reach out to one of the staff members here or myself, because I know that they want to put more emphasis into it. The task force is comprised of, I think it's 16 or 18 different career officers from schools, from officers at all the various schools across campus, and they meet three or four times a year to discuss programming events and things to put on. So they're always looking for new input of the type of events that would be that are looked for, and so they're looking forward to your input. So I hope you enjoy this evening tonight as well. I'd like to take this opportunity to present our two speakers tonight. First, since 1987, James Brown has been working as a labor market analyst at the New York State Department of Labor, and looks forward to providing us with an economic analysis of the city's current job market. And he's going to speak first. Afterwards, Gary Golden, who is here somewhere, in the back there. He's an academically trained futurist at FutureThink, and he will discuss issues shaping society and business in the 21st century. We ask that you hold your questions, your Q&A, until the end for both presenters. So please join me in welcoming James and Gary. Up first is James Brown.
My bio actually makes me sound younger than I am. I've been covering New York City since 1987. Before that, I worked covering Long Island, and before that, I worked covering the Hudson Valley. And I have been with the Department of Labor 34 years, which is hard to believe sometimes. But what I usually tell people that means is this is my third financial crisis, major recession. I was around for the savings and loan crisis. I was around for that lovely little accident when they lost 22% of the stock exchange market value in one trading day. And of course, here I am again and the dot-com bust. Let's not forget that one. So I guess it's four major market events and three major recessions. They're all different, and yet somehow they're all the same. And one of the things I've come to realize is, because this is the third time I've gone through the, we have no job growth, it's a jobless recovery, we're never going to have job growth, whatever. I remember being here in 2004, not here physically, but in the city and the market, and everyone's going, recovery's never coming. And then it came. And I remember being there in 92 and 93, and they were laying off people left and right. And by 96, the employers were calling, asking me where to find workers. I'm a civil servant, so I can't say, call all the people you laid off. But yeah, so we've been through, no one ever sees the booms coming. No one saw the late 90s coming. No one saw what we just went through in the previous decade coming. And absolutely nobody saw the mid 80s coming. I knew about New York City coming into that. We were basically being written off as dead. I mean, all through the, from 69 to 78, New York City essentially lost Buffalo. It's the way I like to describe it. We lost more jobs than there are people working in Buffalo, or back then in Buffalo. Buffalo's smaller now, of course. So we've been through this before, and somehow we keep coming out of it. And I'm a pessimist by nature. I was born in New York City, raised in New York City. It's real simple. But I've seen this go on for a long time, and the interesting thing is it's actually been getting better cycle to cycle. In that, as when I was first getting into this business, it was standard for them to tell you, well, of course, New York City always underperforms the nation. We'll never do as well as the national economy. You know, they've got all that cheap land, low taxes, booming populations. How could we possibly outperform the national economy? We've got all these, you know, high taxes, expensive real estate, it's crowded, the infrastructure's lousy, all these issues. How could we possibly outperform the national economy? Well, as you can see, we did it during the last cycle. We were actually stayed positive much longer than the national economy, which is that black line, managed. And we didn't suffer as severe losses, and we bounced back faster, and we're growing faster. So for this whole cycle, for the last almost 10 years now, the city has been outpacing the nation in job creation. It may not feel like it, especially if you're looking for a job. It may seem incredible to have someone stand here and tell you, we're doing better than the nation. Some of that's how bad the nation has done. And some of it's to understand our role in things, which is we were at the end of the pipeline. When the national economy started slowing, and you can see the line starts down in the middle of 2005, when the national economy started slowing, that's the housing boom starting to unwind. And of course, it hammers first those people who depend heavily on building new houses. So South Florida, Phoenix, Las Vegas, Southern California, all got hammered fairly early. Most of those states, Florida, whatever, Arizona, were in recession by 2006. And we were still bubbling along. And then 2007 came, and it's getting nasty everywhere, and we're still bubbling along. Reporters keep calling and going, your numbers must be wrong. You know, we're still growing, and everyone else is in trouble. Well, we were at the end of the pipeline. You know, first the housing goes bad, then the whole economy tanks. Then the bad housing turns into bad mortgages, and it shows up on our doorstep. So it took a long time to show up, and you can see when it arrived with a bang. In one quarter, we went from pretty decent over-the-air job growth to a strong negative position. It happened like that, third quarter and then into the fourth quarter of 08. It was a very fast, severe downturn. We actually came out of it much faster than usual. The recessions usually last longer in the New York City than they do nationally. And this time we did better than average. And we've been, hard to believe, but we are now in our entering, I guess it will be our fifth year of job growth. We just keep adding jobs. And New York City is actually back above where we were going into the recession. That is not true of the nation. We need at least another year, 18 months of good, solid economic growth nationally, and maybe we'll get back to where we were in 2007. And therein lies part of the problem, because it would be nice, you know, in economics, they always have these lovely theories, and then the little line at the end says, all other things being equal. Yeah, yes, right. Because we pull out our magic economic freeze ray, and we stop everything else from happening, and we test this one variable, and it's fine. It works great. But in real life, of course, things just keep happening. Pieces move. So 7 years go by, and every year, people keep graduating high school and college and expecting there to be jobs. I know it's darn inconsiderate of them, but they just keep doing it. So 7 years of no job, net job growth, means you have a much higher unemployment rate. So even though New York City is right back where it was, in fact, above where it was substantially in terms of job growth, the unemployment rate is still much higher. And the red line is New York City. New York City always has higher unemployment rates, pretty much. I mean, it gives you an idea of how strong our economy was in the last upturn and how bad the nation was in the last downturn, that we had similar unemployment rates. We're pretty much always above the national rate. And there were some demographic reasons for that, but you'll see it is slowly working its way down. For finally down below the peak of the previous recession, which gives you an idea how nasty things got. But, you know, 7 years of basically treading water and you get still high unemployment. And you see the national rate has really started to move down. Get down towards six, much below six, and you start to get a lot of stories about labor shortages. Not that in general labor is short, but you start to get spot shortages. So this is the broad picture of how the city has done. We've had 4 full years of job growth. 2014 looks like it's going to be a solid year. And we are outperforming the nation, although the nation is starting to catch up. It's interesting because I talk to groups all the time about unemployment, and something that comes up a lot, of course, is age discrimination. And it surely exists. I'm a labor economist. When you study labor markets, you find massive numbers of inefficiencies. There's all sorts of discriminations, preferences. It's sort of interesting in labor economics. In theory, every time a business doesn't hire someone because they're too short, too tall, wrong gender, wrong age, wrong color, whatever else, they're making any non-economic decision that damages their productivity. Doesn't mean they don't do it. Just means in economic theory, it'd be a stupid thing to do. People keep right on doing it. But the interesting thing, of course, is that you see there is some difference by age as you move up in unemployment, particularly for men. Somewhat higher as you get older. But the real penalty in the labor market by age is being young. Unemployment rates are sky high for teenagers and still well over 10% for people late years of college, first years out of college. And this is consistent. Good times and bads. The levels may move down and up, but the ratios are pretty consistent. Because what you're really being punished for in the labor market is lack of something to charge for. You don't have experience, you don't have credentials, you don't have whatever they're looking for, degrees, and you're lacking that. So you have this real penalty on lack of experience, lack of credentials. As it comes down, as you get to the age where you have some work experience, where you're starting to get your skills packaged together, unemployment drops sharply and sort of levels off, you know, relative to the other age groups. This is one of the sort of nasty surprises we've had, and one of the reasons this recession has felt, or recovery has felt so weak, is this is what's called part-time for economic reasons. And what it boils down to is you have a part-time job and you wish a full-time job. And at this point, we have about 4.5% of the workforce are working part-time and they wish to be working full-time. When you hear discussions or see articles where they discuss the real unemployment rate, this is the biggest factor in that. They take this and they add it to the underlying traditional unemployment rate. Because presumably these people are still looking for full-time work. They want full-time work. You will notice it got particularly high in this downturn. Downturn lasted a long time in terms of getting back to where we were. People had to compromise, people had to settle. And so we have more people than usual, far more than in the previous recession. By the way, a percentage point in New York City equals like 40,000 people. Having to settle for a part-time job, and it's really only back down a little. It hasn't made any substantial move down. So there's still a lot of weakness in the labor market, even though we have had decent job growth. These people have had to, in many cases, settle for a secondary job, not what they want. And that's part of why it feels particularly difficult when you're looking for work, even as you see the overall unemployment rate start to move down. This is an issue nationally, too. It's not quite as bad, but you see that, too. So you see that 6% or 6.5% rate for the nation, you think, that's reasonable. But then, of course, there's these people who can't find full-time work and want it. So they're going to keep pushing. They're going to keep trying to get a full-time job. I threw in one of the issues that I mentioned before. New York City has generally had higher unemployment rates than the nation. This is from 25-year-olds and up. It gives you time to have gotten your credentials. New York City has a sort of an odd shape to its labor market. We have far more college graduates than the U.S. as a whole, and we have far more people who never finished high school. And of course, unemployment is very closely tied to education. So you put in a table that shows unemployment by education level, and you see for the college degree people, it's in the low single digits. And for the less than high school, it's in the upper teens to low 20s. So one of the reasons we have a high unemployment rate is the city has a large pool of people who have very low educational credentials. And we also, of course, have this high level of, you know, people with very strong credentials. And then, of course, we're actually somewhat weaker in the middle. So when you hear about a lack of middle-class jobs, that's part of what they're talking about. Job market in New York City skews toward people who have very high credentials. You see somewhat the same thing in earnings. Compared to the nation, you actually make less as a high school dropout in New York City than the average they do nationally. And you can picture trying to live in an expensive place like New York City. And there is, of course, as the educational credentials climb, the differential starts to open up in favor of New York City. It is a high-wage city, but the high wages predominantly go to the people who have advanced degrees. I mean, overwhelmingly. You don't really get any significant opening in wage differential until you have at least some college credits or an associate's degree. This is sort of interesting because it's not the way people picture it. About 60% of the private sector jobs are in Manhattan. So that's still the bulk of the jobs. But if you look back over the last decade, Manhattan is actually in fourth place in terms of job growth. We've had very rapid job growth in Brooklyn. It's almost 25% in the last 10 years. There's been an immense amount of development in the downtown area, businesses moving in. Big professional services and business services cluster has formed there. Some financial company back offices, a lot of development of hotels, restaurants, stores, as neighborhoods have developed. So Brooklyn's had a lot of strong job growth. The Bronx has actually done surprisingly well in terms of residential-related development. So they've actually shown a fair amount of growth in middle and upper-income people moving into the borough, and then you get growth in supporting jobs. You get personal services, dry cleaners open up, stores open up, fitness clubs pop up. You start to get growth in ancillary industries that serve the local population, and, of course, healthcare and whatever else to serve the population. Queens has been sort of in the middle and is probably the leader for doing best the next decade because of all the changes they're making in the Long Island City area. They're really pushing to job development in Long Island City. So we're going to see a lot of what we saw in downtown and such Brooklyn is starting to happen in Long Island City now. And that's probably the next big frontier, if you will. And Staten Island looks more like a suburban area in most demographics. But they're also somewhat hindered by the fact that the job base on Staten Island is heavily weighted toward government jobs. And government has not been a growth area. You've probably heard a lot, you read the press, and you get a lot of stories about how everyone's now a part-time worker, and I sort of alluded to there has been some growth there, and how everyone's self-employed. No one can get a permanent job anymore. The interesting thing is 77% of the people are still on the payroll of a corporation. And another 13% are on the payroll of a government. So 90% of the people who have jobs are still on the payroll of a company. They're not freelancing. They're not self-employed. They may be doing some of that on the side. There's been a real growth in second incomes, where people both have a job and do projects on the side. But primary income source is still mostly from working for pay, on salary of a company. And the big shift since before the recession, if you go back to 2007 and look at this data, the private for-profit sector was 66%, and the government was 15%. So between 2007 and 2012, the city added something like 30,000 jobs, 30,000 more employed residents. All the gain and more came in the nonprofit and profit-making corporate sectors. There's been a large loss of government jobs and very little growth in self-employment. I mean, you hear about self-employment a lot, but the actual numbers show that self-employment has been relatively stable. And part of that is some of it's growing, And that stuff is really jazzy and sexy, and people talk about it in the magazines, you know. Computer consultants and freelance graphics people, and that's always talked about. And of course, reporters are in one of those industries that the internet is busily destroying. And every one of them knows someone who's been laid off or is working in, is now working freelance or in some way has been impacted negatively by technological shifts. So reporters in particular are very negative on freelancing and negative and self-employment. But beyond that gee whiz part of all these people doing, you know, complicated things for high pay, most self-employment in New York City is people running small stores and people offering personal services. Cab drivers, house cleaners, child care workers, all self-employed. So when you look at the largest self-employed occupations in New York City, it's not artists, musicians, actors, it's child care worker. And then you get taxi cab driver, and you get house cleaner, and then you start to see a complete shift into the artistic fields and the creative fields. But that's where the big move toward self-employment has been, in mostly the artistic creative fields. And they've always had a high component of self-employment, but it's been growing. In many other areas, the biggest shift has not been that you're no longer on a company's payroll, but that they move you off one company payroll onto another. The largest shift while I've been studying the job market has been companies taking all their different support functions and outsourcing them. So now the janitors and the secretarial pool and the IT support and the call center and everything else is done by some other company. And you only have the core function left at, say, a big bank. And they've outsourced almost everything else. But most of those people are still on some other company's payroll. They've just shifted them off to a different company. The big change, again, this 2007, 2012, real big shift. That top line is managerial, professional, and creative occupations. That's where the growth has been. We've added over 80,000 jobs in those type of occupations since the 2007 peak. And the service occupations, which again are things such as the restaurant and hospitality industry, house cleaners, security guard firms, those type of support and service firms are also showing a lot of growth. So you've got high end and low end, and then you move down, production, of course, and transportation, some losses, construction, well, it was a big construction downturn, no surprise there, and sales and office occupations. It's the sales and clerical jobs that have taken the brunt of the downturn. There's been a huge shift inside the market. The overall numbers are relatively close between 2007 and 2012, but you have this huge shift of plus 80,000 managerial professional and minus almost 60,000 sales and office jobs. And of course, just because you lost a sales job doesn't mean you can turn into a management worker. So there's this mismatch problem too that helps keep the labor market feeling difficult. There's a lot of economic demand, but it's for certain types of skills. And meanwhile, people are losing their jobs in other skill areas. These are the industries that have added the most jobs in the last 12 months. There's no zeros missing from this. You're used to the national numbers, you know, you're thinking, oh, it's 7.7 million, wow. And you see the same sort of mix. There are low-end things. Home health care services are doing very well. Limited service restaurants are doing very well. There's some retail mixed in there. And then you start to see, well, colleges are doing well. Advertising has actually come on very strong the last few years. Performing arts, wholesalers, durable goods wholesalers are actually showing some strength, oddly enough. And you don't think of that as a growth industry. Computer systems design, there's been some movement in credit intermediation, which is our fancy term for what amounts to banking and credit granting organizations. That primarily reflects the fact that our large financial conglomerates are changing the way they're structured. And they're actually adding people in some of the credit type operations at the same time as the securities and investment banking side is shrinking. So you might see the same company have overall unchanged unemployment, but they're laying off thousands of people in one area and bringing in thousands in another over a few years. So it's been a real shift here. So there's high end, there's low end. Some of this is driven by tourism. You know, the restaurant industry is doing well. The clothing store industry is doing well. That both serves the local needs and it serves the tourism industry. And you see advertising and computer systems. Professional industries generally have been strong. The exception is the legal industry. It was a very, very steady performer for decades. It took a little bit of a hit back in 2000, the 2000 downturn, and a much bigger hit in this downturn. We had essentially a 10% job loss in New York City law firms in a one-year period during the downturn, and they've never really recovered. They showed a little bounce back in 2009, 2000, 2010, 2011, and then it started slowly dwindling down again. It's relatively stable now, but there's no real growth there. And there have been some issues. A number of high-profile law firms have ended up in trouble, overexpansion, expensive real estate leases, basically bad business decisions that a less forgiving market makes them pay for. I mean, if business was great and their hourly rates were still skyrocketing, then it wouldn't matter as much that maybe they overpaid for their real estate or promised some new part of their practice, excessive bonuses or whatever else, they could cover it. But it's really been the standout weak area in the professional industries has been legal services. The surprise strong area is actually the advertising agencies. I mean, we were worried for a long time about advertising because New York City has an issue or had an issue that we are old line media. We have a lot of newspaper and magazine companies. We have a lot of TV companies. We have the big old advertising agencies who helped place ads in such medias. And, you know, and advertising shifted into the, I don't know what you want to call it, onto the internet, into social media, whatever else. As it shifted, no one was sure that the New York City advertising industry would survive, or at least would continue to prosper. And in fact, they've made a reasonably decent transition. And we've seen a lot of growth the last few years. But again, one of the issues you deal with is if you've been in advertising and you have a lot of experience placing classified ads with newspapers, you know, that business is slowly going away. That doesn't make you particularly well suited to then transition into social media management. Some of the gaffes that keep plummeting on the internet, I'm not sure people doing social media management understand it too well either. But they're learning and they're slowly progressing and, you know, they are making it happen. And we've really been successful. And again, I keep going through these trends. I was, of course, here for the dot-com thing. And completely unexpected by anyone, with absolutely no government intervention, except not enforcing loft laws, we suddenly had this collection of tech companies booming in downtown Manhattan. Unfortunately, most of them went broke. You know, and we didn't get most of the winners. And when we had the dot-com boom going on, if you had taken all the smart people on Wall Street and said to them, I got a bet for you. When the smoke clears, the winner's going to be a bookstore, someone running a junk sale, you know. they would have looked at you like, what are you, crazy, you know? Oh, and some guy selling, letting you look up things and then putting a map next to it, you know. What? You know? Right, you know, so, but all the great ideas they put millions and billions behind, you know, Webvan and whatever else, pets.com, mostly they failed. And in some cases, the names got taken over by surviving companies, but mostly those companies failed. And when the smoke cleared, we had Amazon and we had eBay, you know, and then slowly comes rising things like Google. But yeah, we didn't really win in that round. But in this round, we seem to be doing a lot better. In the social media side, we've had a lot of big winning companies, you know, including Google, really expanding in the New York City job market. We've done really well in that area, and hopefully this will help us going forward. It's one of the reasons the management side is so strong. A lot of that will be captured in computer systems, you know, or advertising-related services. We're having some interesting issues about how to code some of these companies. And it doesn't necessarily relate to what kind of job they have. But we've really been successful there. And looking into New York into 2014, the strength we have is primarily coming from professional services, particularly advertising and computer, and leisure and hospitality, helped by a real strong tourism market. And other than that, it's just serving the local needs of 8.5 million people who make a pretty good average salary. And I thank you.
Thank you, James, so much. We'd now like to invite Gary Golden, our second speaker of the evening, to the floor. Let me just fix the presentation a minute.
One, two, testing one, two, perfect. All right, so I come from Brooklyn, so I was thrilled to see the job growth there. I don't have the statistics, but I'm guessing that a majority of that comes from the entrepreneurial millennials that have food carts, right, selling $10 lobster rolls and $10 peanut butter and jelly sandwiches, which have taken up about 15% of my income this year off of food carts. So very happy to be here. I've done several events with Columbia in recent weeks, and thrilled to be with the graduate alumni network. So this is the game plan for the next 30 minutes. We're going to walk through three sections. First, I'm going to have fun with you. We're going to play a game called In the News. It's very similar to Wait, Wait, Don't Tell Me. We're going to look at stories that are basically weak signals of change, and your job is going to vote on whether you think it's true or false. Then I'm going to introduce one foresight framework. And kind of give you a little bit more background on, you know, what it means to be a professional futurist, what it does not mean. Then we're going to look at drivers of change, starting at the global level, looking down at, and then walking ourselves down to demographic transitions in the U.S. And cities. And then we're going to focus on the role that data is likely to play in the future job landscape. Before ending with a couple tips and tricks, I tend to find three types of individuals when I do my presentations. There's the futurist, like, I'm gonna start calling myself a futurist, right? Which is bad for me. And they're just, you know, they're on it and they're excited and they already are looking for trends. So what's your next step? Then there's the person that says, it was an interesting presentation, but I don't have the time, I don't have the bandwidth. So what is that person's next step? And then there's the person that thinks I'm just a snake oil salesman, they can't believe the company's paid me to speak, and you're a skeptic, right? So what would be your next steps? So that's the agenda for the program. Many of you may know Wait, Wait, Don't Tell Me is a game on NPR. It's a very expensive trademark. I borrowed liberally from the concept. My game is called In the News. So what we're going to do here is we're going to look at two stories, and these are, again, stories that I've detected in the world, and your job is to tell me whether you think they're true or false. Now, if you think the story is true, I want you to kind of, you know, go back to, you know, your glory days, football game, some sort of event, and I want you to stand up and I want you to give me jazz hands, right, if you think that this is true, right? And if you're unable or unwilling to stand, just give me your best jazz hands, right? And if you think it's false, I just want you to kind of fold your hands all grumpy like you don't want to play a game, right? So the first story comes out of the world of retail and HR, deals with this trend of micro-credentials, and the true-false is Ben Sherman, large fashion brand across the pond, now working with the Mozilla Foundation on a series of badges, so micro-credentials, that reflect skills that have been demonstrated, you know, with various institutions, that individuals have learned either inside a formal Ben Sherman training program or outside in some sort of non-traditional learning environment. So, you've been sitting for 30 minutes. I want to give you a chance to stand up. Stand up, give me your jazz hands. If you think this is true, fold your hands, look grumpy if you think it's false. Stay standing, right? So folks, look at these people. Columbia, it is a two-hand jazz hands here. Look at these folks, right? These are the visionaries, the entrepreneurs, the risk takers in your alumni network, and they are wrong. They are wrong. But you're my people. You're my people. So what does this mean? Why is this important? So there are a lot of people on the kind of evangelical side of badges, right? They've got companies that deal with badges and micro-credentialing. It is a part of their, you know, to put bread on the table, they need to oversell and overhype this trend. So I'm admitting that there is a bit of overselling here. But there are also people out there that say, look, the world has fundamentally changed in terms of, you know, how people understand their skill sets and how employers understand what you can actually do. That goes much deeper than having a degree from a particular institution that you received 10, 20 years ago. So there is this expectation that there will be a breaking down process of our skills building, and badges are one form of micro-credential. So there are lots of people that think badges are great and they're fantastic, and then there are other people that say, oh, we don't need your stinking badges, right? So this is true in a lot of places, and the conversation and the infrastructure building of digital badges through Mozilla is in its fourth year. So we're starting to see a little bit of traction with institutions. One of them is the Manufacturing Institute, blue collar people that are starting to say, hey, individuals are taking courses and they're learning things beyond traditional learning environments. Maybe badges will help us make sense of that landscape. So badges are, one way, micro-credentials are one way of telling that story. When I'm speaking mostly to students, I like to highlight what I think is the evolution of how individuals maintain and prepare for a re-entry into the job force, right? We all like to think that we're gonna hold on to our jobs, but we do need to be prepared for an event that leads to us in a job-seeking position. So resumes have been the traditional kind of chronological order. They remain very important, but mostly not on paper. They're most important on sites like Monster and LinkedIn, where they can be scraped by bots and algorithms that are looking for keywords. So what is important in our resume position is its machine readability, right? The ability for algorithms, not individuals, to understand the spectrum of our skill sets. So resumes are important, but they're not the most important thing. I think all individuals, regardless of your stature kind of in your growth as a professional, need to be constantly maintaining a portfolio. And a portfolio is that collection of experiences, failures, and successes. What I see upticking in the world of employees and job seekers and individuals that are both freelance and also within large organizations is a greater push towards managing their online presence. Who you know, who is following you, what you're saying, what you think about the world reflects your online presence. So how do we think about our skills, beyond badges and micro-credentials, but all three of these formats that tell very different stories? So second and final question. IBM made an announcement a few weeks ago that they were going to be investing about $1 billion in a new unit dedicated to Watson. So a little bit of background. Watson is basically called a software application based off of natural language interactions, right? It's essentially a decision support tool for individuals. And it became famous a few years ago when it beat the two smartest people on Jeopardy. Wiped them off the stage in somewhat of a circus event in 2011. So the true-false here is IBM Watson now part of a pilot project with North Face in which they've created a personal intelligent assistant that helps deliver more contextual answers through conversation with the person that's in the store or online? So you don't need to stand up for this one. Just give me your best one-handed jazz hand. Let me see those fingers twirl. The true, false, I've got some faces here. You did well on this one. This one is true. So Watson I would argue the most important technological innovation of our age. IBM calls Watson a cognitive computing platform. And the short story of that is that we're moving from a world in which we program computers, we instruct them, you know, how to do certain things, to a world where very sophisticated artificial intelligence like machine learning, deep learning, there's a whole bunch of stuff there. These applications teach themselves. It is a machine that learns by itself. So it will learn over time. So Watson is by far the most sophisticated cognitive computing, intelligent, insistent, natural language decision support tool on the market. Siri is a joke compared to Watson, right? And I'm one of these futurists. I'm a droid PC guy. I still believe in Microsoft. I can't stand Apple, right? Every time I work on Apple, I'm like, why do people make so much of a fuss here? Watson is far and away the most significant one. But this is a field that is starting to heat up. Google has a service called Google Now, which it categorizes as an anticipatory system. So if you're traveling to DC or Seattle and you step off the plane, off the train, you flip up your droid and it says, you know, 20 minutes to your hotel. And you think, I didn't tell Google that I was staying at that hotel, right? And how does it know that there's a traffic accident and it's going to be a little longer, right? It has gone through your emails, scraped that, knows you're staying there, has checked the traffic and has said, you know, this is the best way to go there. Now, there's a line that is very creepy. And for some people, that's a line that they want to stay on this side, right? But then when you realize that Google Now has helped you save an hour sitting in traffic in Chicago and you've taken the train, you're like, well, I'll cross that creepy line, right? So Google Now is one. And then the startup that I have a happily married man, love my wife, but I have a man crush on the CEO of MindMeld, which is a company that has developed a contextual search engine that allows individuals to, again, just naturally speak to the application. And as you speak to the application, it will bring up search results based off of the keywords that you've said and in the context of your life as it knows it. MindMeld has released its application as an API. And its vision is that any organization can build a light version of IBM Watson on top of its products and services. So this is a world in which we need to anticipate jobs, not just being online or social and influenced by all those changes, but a world in which jobs are heavily influenced through artificial intelligence that's not perfect, but much better than anything we've seen in the past. Right? So how do we prepare ourselves for that future? So I'm an academically trained futurist. I attended a graduate degree program at the University of Houston. There is a future studies program there that grew out of a culture in the 1960s and 70s in Houston around NASA and the hydrocarbon sector. So both of those industries needed to develop a better way of having a structured look at long-term change. So future studies is not a crackpot discipline. It is essentially the study of social change. And there are many qualitative and quantitative forecasting methods that we use. I don't have time to go into them. I want to just plant one seed. And it is a technique, a frame, kind of a lens that futurists use. Was popularized by colleagues at the University of Hawaii Future Studies program. And it's called Four Futures. So if we think about the future of an industry, the future of a community or a country, we can imagine there are four potential outcomes, right? There's the continued growth. This is the world in which, you know, things that we do are fine, and we just continue to do that and kind of blue skies ahead, right? Then there's the disciplined, constrained future. This is the world where we still do the same thing. Our job is essentially the same, but there's more headwinds pushing on us. A little bit more difficult. So if I'm Microsoft or I'm a coal company, I'm looking at a constrained future. Then there's a transformed future. This is a world where we look around and we say, you know what? The world has changed, and our business is fundamentally different than in the past. So you go across the river over to New Jersey. For 30 years, the pharmaceutical sector was built by chemical engineers, chemical synthesis of pharmaceuticals. And over the past 5 years, they have been transforming that industry towards biologics, biological engineering. IBM went from a hardware company to a service company. That's a transformed future. And then there's the decline collapse, right? This is the Kodak and the BlackBerry world, right? Where you just look at the future and you say, it doesn't look good. So futurists will work with clients to help them imagine a range of scenarios, right? The whole purpose of thinking about the future is to be able to imagine a range of outcomes over multiple time horizons, right, and multiple scenarios. You're not trying to predict what will happen. That is impossible, right? You're really trying to prepare for what we call a cone of plausibility. So that's the introduction to foresight. I want to move now to drivers of change. Very grateful to hear Jim's comments that were highly localized. I'm going to start at a much higher level. I think kind of with the global story. I think a skill set that all individuals will need, regardless of your current kind of job professional duties, is to hone in on your capacity to understand demographic transitions, right? So big changes in large groups of people, and then also be able to develop business strategies that create demand, create consumer or business demand. So I want to look, what is the lens then that's going to shape this? So the world as we know it, you know, really started after World War II. Prior to that, you know, 50 years, it was that unwinding of the colonial age, right? Really, life as we know it in America started after World War II. That was the world where the West and West economy defined job creation and job dynamics, right? And then in the 1990s, we saw some demographic shifts in East Asia, shift in technology, cost structures started to change in major industries, and we started to see growth around globalization of an East to West economy, right? And this is a story I think we all know well. What is the next era for globalization in terms of flows and dynamics? We've done West to West, East to West.
Maybe North to South.
North to South, right? That is the one that has the biggest dollars, right? That's the one that has the biggest kind of wealth transfer. The one that I think is most strategic, right? Much smaller by size, right? There's no measure that's gonna, you know, beat out North to South. But the one that is most critical as a global strategy is the South to South economy. This is not a world where it matters what the US does with Angola, what US does with India. It's a world where what matters most is what India and Angola, what China and Nigeria do together. The Southern Hemisphere to Southern Hemisphere cultural and economic interactions, I would argue, are the most important investment that we need to make to have the jobs that will, you know, drive us forward. Why? Because these are the nations that have what economists and demographers will call the demographic dividend. A demographic dividend is about a 20 or 30 year period in which societies have a large number of young people that they've invested in go through their teenage college years, through their first jobs, and enter that peak earning season, let's say mid-30s, late 50s. That is the demographic dividend. Right? In the US, our demographic dividend was in the 90s. That was, you know, big box retail, get rid of my minivan, I'm gonna get an SUV, right? I'm gonna get a house with a closet that was bigger than my bedroom in my old house. We had a demographic dividend payout of the baby boomers in the 1990s. The demographic dividends of the future are going to be in India and Pakistan and Angola and Nigeria. And we can sit back and we can say, well, let them, good luck, right? And think about job growth here. Or we can say, you know what? Our professional services, our skills to enable a successful South-to-South economy will lead to more jobs in the United States, right? They will lead to, we'll become China's healthcare service provider. That would be great. We'll become India's education provider. They would love it. We would love it, right? So how do we think of the job landscape proactively around investments in the South-to-South economy? So this is a map that has floated around the internet in recent days. It was created by a Reddit user. Oh my goodness, I'm way behind. And it was, I was like, Jim's gonna hate this, right? It's a bit shady, right? It's economic activity, basically in metro regions. You know, there's no Denver. So I kind of, I don't really agree with it, but it points to the real story. And the real story here is that when you think about the creation of jobs and policies that create jobs and investments and organization of individuals, it has become localized at the metro level. Metropolitan regions are driving innovation and driving job creation, much even more so than state or federal policies, right? So how do we teach ourselves the various lenses of metropolitan economies? And we'll kind of let you learn more through those various lenses. So that's the global picture. Then there's the city metro picture. I want to end this part with a look at what I think is the most important demographic transition for the U.S. economy to get right. And that is reversing the popular assumption that aging and the aging of the baby boomer population is a terrible thing. Flipping that around in a way that we describe aging as active aging, as creative aging, that empowers aging baby boomers to live longer, healthier, more active lives. Why? Because they got all the money. They have all the money. And there are a lot of poor baby boomers that are going to be aging that need help. It's, a big spectrum. Active aging and this idea of jobs to support aging in place, where your mother or father can live in their home or they can live with roommates and they don't have to go to an institution. Aging in place. Those types of jobs, I think, are going to enable the wealth to be recycled in that group. All right. I've got how many minutes? Love it. So we're going to shift gears here. We're going to move from people and demographics, and we're going to talk about data. I want to get your minds. You've had long days. I know you've had long days. There's something in your mind that actually, there's a trigger in your mind that opens up the process of learning, and it's the lever is a big fake smile. So I want to see the biggest fake smile across this Columbia Alumni Network group that I can. Oh, Harvard was much better, guys. Come on, come on, come on. All right, there we go. So data, right? And when you're a futurist and you go out in the world, people will be like, are you going to talk about big data, right? And it's just like a big target, and they're going to hate it, and they think it's a bunch of, BS marketing stuff. So, you cannot avoid data, right? So I'm going to try to give you a different lens around data. So data is not really the story, right? There's absolutely an explosion in data. Big data, by definition, the way to think about it is the three V's, right? Volume, the amount, velocity, right? The speed, real time, and variety, right? We have sentiment status update data. We have doors data from light bulbs, data from your cars. Data is coming from different various sources. So the three V's. Most people, they don't need to worry about big data in their everyday jobs, right? Most people don't need to worry about that, unless you're in finance or healthcare or retail. What is really important is going to be the algorithms and the software applications that take that data and create value. That is the most important story. And this is a world that can be very frightening because it leads you to think in terms of, you know, my job is going to be lost, right? Just like the blue-collar worker who lost his job to a robot, you know, me, the accountant, if you're a media ad buying in media, I got a software program that can do your job better than you can, right? There's a fear factor of automation. And a great book to get yourself kind of framed is called The Second Machine Age. This is happening in industries far and wide. This notion of kind of automation is happening in the biosciences. There's a company called Transcriptic, which basically takes lab work that humans have done and automates it through robotics. So there's a very scary scenario of massive disruption through software automation, right? I do not think that scenario will be true. I really don't think it's going to be true. But in order for it to not be true, we're going to have to realize what's the positive scenario, right? And the positive scenario is captured here by Eric Walters, right? Yeah, automatic, you know, stuff on the bench, great. I hated doing that in college, right? So the attitude is going to have to become, great, take the menial, you know, stuff that I hate doing in my service and knowledge sector job, take all that stuff, put it away, give me the creative, juicy stuff. So what are jobs that are likely to come out of this world? They're going to be jobs that can capture and create new forms of data, right? Both from individuals, various social, you know, environments. There are going to be jobs and industries and companies that are able to capture data from a field that we now refer to as connected devices, right? This is a world in which, you know, your car is, you know, producing tremendous amount of data. Google purchased Nest for $3 billion. Nest is a thermostat company and a smoke alarm company. They're creating connected devices for a smart home, right? This world of personal data and connected to device data requires companies to establish relationships with individuals based off of trust, right? And your job, I think, is going to be to help build that trust with your customers, whether they're consumers or business, in this future. I think that will be part of our duties. So just to give you a perspective of, you know, you think, oh, a talking thermostat, there's talking toothbrushes, right? The toothbrush is a connected device, and it knows that your three-year-old, you know, only brushed for 30 seconds, and then it, you know, gives you data. You're like, these things are ridiculous, right? This notion of connected devices falls under the framing of Internet of Things sometimes. It will be larger than the smartphones and the PC world, right? So how do we prepare for a world in which tremendous amounts of data drive innovation in our industries? So I want to end with two things that I think you need to learn more about. Two ways of thinking about data that I think will improve your ability to thrive in this world. The first is to recognize that there's a value chain to data, right? The least descriptive data that exists in the world is descriptive. It's what happened. And most of us, our jobs are based off of descriptive data reports. You come into a meeting and it's like you give, you know, your colleagues data of what happened in the past, right? That's 1950s stuff. The more valuable form of data and analytics insight is predictive. And as we look at the future of our jobs, the ability to work with predictive software programs will be part of our everyday. But the most valuable form of data, the most valuable form of insight that you can, you know, capture on your own as a person, the most valuable form of insight that you can deliver to your clients, to your customers, to the consumer, is prescriptive. It's the recommendation. What should come next? Right? So there are now health companies that are being prescriptive. You should do this if you want to achieve that outcome. There are financial banks are developing prescriptive services that say, if you want to achieve this outcome, you need to do this. Students are working with prescriptive, adaptive learning tools. So this is the first lens. The first lens is get your job out of the descriptive data set, get your job into the predictive and prescriptive world. And this will require you to go out and get a badge, right? It's going to require you to take a course on data science. It's going to require you to learn more, right? So that's the first thing. The second thing, and I'm done, my fire hose is done in three slides here. The second thing I think you want to learn more about is how we choose to structure data. Most of us have been working with data in our jobs around tables, Excel spreadsheets, rows and columns, what we call relational databases, right? Made Oracle a very big company. And when we look at the world today and we look at innovation, the structure of how people store data is in a graph. It's in a graph. And a graph is essentially kind of a node and a connector, right? So Lisa and John are friends, and she's a patron of the theater, he's a trustee, and Bill's over here, we don't know Bill. He attends a show, he meets Lisa, now Bill has a way to introduce himself to John, right? It's a graph. Graph structures have been behind the most dynamic companies of the past 15 years. Google's essentially a link graph company, right? Their search engine was better because they said, well, if 100 people are linking to that node is the most important node in that search. And then the interest graph came along, match.com, Instagram tags, Twitter, that's an interest graph. The social graph is LinkedIn, Facebook. The most dynamic companies of our age think about the world in terms of relationships of things, not relational spreadsheet Excel databases from hell, but relationships, connected data. So if you are in an industry that deals with learning or training or health or transportation or finance, you want to think about how graph-based data might change the future of your job. So a thing and a fun thing you can do kind of to get yourself started, go to MIT has that application called Immersion. And you're going to have to take a leap of faith, cross the creepy line. You put in your email address, and it will show you your personal graph in terms of people you know. And you're going to look up here and be like, ooh, I hate him, right? He makes me email him all the time. So I've got a website that's up. You're thinking, what is he talking about with graphs, right? I'll give you videos to watch. I'm a fire hose speaker. I know I throw a lot at you at 7 o'clock on a, you know, a weekday. We've had a long day at work. This is usually the face that I get from people, right? It's that shock and awe, like, I don't want to deal with Watson at work, right? This is the face that I want to get you to. I got a 3-year-old and a 3-month-old. This is the 3-year-old when he was 6 months and adorable before he became a little, you know, turd. There was a point in your life where you just said, I don't understand things, and you had a smile on your face, and you were like, I'm going to move towards it, right? I don't understand the keys. I'm going to shake them. I'm going to throw them in the trash. Watch Dad get mad. I don't understand the door. I'm going to open and close the door 25,000 times because I don't understand it. And you had a smile on your face. And now people come in front of you, and they say, oh, you know, data is going to be part of your world. You're going to have to learn predictive analytics tools. You're going to be working with an artificial agent. And you're like, I don't want to do that. I don't want to have to get on Twitter, right? And we're grumpy. We're grumpy. So I want to figure out a way to get you to do it with a smile on your face. If you're that futurist, that's awesome, and your job is to socialize awesome, right? Your job is to form a signals team within your organization. Get 3 people that are just curious and say, look, we're going to scan the news, and then we're going to have our own little TED Talk on the last Friday of every month. And we're going to, you know, take over the break room and present to our colleagues the ideas that we think are going to change our industry. If you're someone that thinks, you know, I'm the empowerment person, I like this stuff, I want to empower others, I don't have time, Your job is to lower the barriers to experimentation. Your job is to encourage smart risk-taking within your teams, right? And if you think that I am filled with nonsense and that IBM Watson is not going to change the healthcare industry and IBM Watson, if you think that, that is perfectly fine because futurists have been wrong before. We've been wrong before. Your job is to figure out which assumptions I hold are wrong. So I have two R's in my name. There's a Gary with one R. He's British, running on the run from the British government, living in Columbia. Happy to take emails, but if you write me, make sure you have two R's in that message. And then I've got this website. It is live. A copy of the presentation is online. I've got some resources up there now, and I will be uploading more videos and stuff this evening. So with that, I went over by a few minutes, so turn it over to Dan.
Okay, thank you. Well, I think that was fascinating. I think we can all agree that was made for a really wonderful program. Gary, thank you very much, and James, thank you also. So next, I'd like to invite both speakers, after you take a little water and refresh for a moment, to have a seat up front. We're gonna have a few moments to digest this information, think about it, and see what questions we have. I think it was a lot of thought-provoking things. I, for one, am not sure exactly what to make of all the information that Gary threw at us. I think it was very interesting, but just to get the ball thinking, ball rolling. Is the message really that we need to retool our education skills and get on board and learn about networks, about graphs, and try to figure something out? Is that?
I think the message is you need to get curious again. You need to learn more about things. What those things are, I've presented a few, but for your world, it might be something completely different. But if you're curious enough and you watch for those weak signals, I think the thing that needs to be done is you need to learn more about how the world is changing.
How the world is
and
changing.
Absolutely. Mm-hmm. Skills building is the way forward. And, you know, there's MOOCs, these massive online courses, similar to badges, lots of hype, lots of overselling in the near term. But don't underestimate it in the long term, I think.
So if I can just, in my thinking about this topic, it seems as though I'm really missing out on how to make use of all the social media, the Facebook, the LinkedIn, the Twitter. I mean, one message I think I got is that I cannot be, lazy about this. I got to really think about getting a message out. Like, I know people, friends of mine they have a Twitter account, and they're just sending stuff out there to gather people to link to them and to follow them. So is it about building a network and building a message and building a brand that's about yourself?
It's about ideas that you find intriguing. The way to succeed on Twitter is not by tweeting about yourself. Every once in a while, put a tweet of your kids online, right? Put something personal. The way the brand is, these are the ideas, the ways of thinking that Dan finds fascinating. I'm not following Dan, I'm following the ideas that he finds fascinating. So I think that is your brand, is mm-hmm. to surround yourself with interesting ways of thinking. Not to tweet that you got a donut on Fifth Avenue. People that say they hate Twitter, they think it's stupid, believe that that's what Twitter is about. And it's not. It's about sharing ideas.
So, for example, my son, who has a Facebook page and has 2,000 friends on Facebook, I shouldn't discourage that. I mean, in the years to come, that will be his entree into a forum to share ideas and he's really going in the right direction by having this forum.
As long as he's not posting pictures of Friday night stuff.
Okay, all right.
Absolutely, there are risks in sharing too much personal, but that's a conversation for another.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. Any more questions, please? Yes, right here.
Okay. So.
Yep. Go right ahead.
It doesn't matter.
I think for the video.
Oh. Okay. Well, I'm just wondering what both of you, what is the future of the workplace? Is this all going to be remote, or is there actually going to be a gathering of people that have to interact with each other? I mean, what you're describing is a bunch of people, sitting around tweeting their thoughts about whatever, you know, just their wonderful impressions about their ideas in urban settings while we all starve to death because no one cares about the farming or, you know. I mean, how fascinating are these people's ideas, and how long do you want to sit there following people's ideas? I mean, don't you want to just, like, sign off and eat at some point?
Yeah, I mean, if I can just add to that.
Workplace, yeah.
Well, I guess it depends on how long you want to look into the future. I mean, part of what I was, I guess, trying to get across in my data is that although you hear a lot about change, change is around the fringe. I mean, I was sitting in the late 90s listening to stories about how the internet was going to destroy the newspaper industry. And slowly but surely it is. But most of the people who bet against the newspaper industry went broke before it happened. So you can read about so much about change, you think it's happening tomorrow. As I said, most people still work for companies. They still get paychecks. Companies are almost incredibly old-fashioned in the way they evaluate work. They like to see bodies. I mean, my favorite of all time Dilbert cartoon is one where he decides to save energy by getting a wood-burning stove, and then to save wood costs by bringing printouts home and burning them. And then he gets promoted because he's taking so much work home. All his boss knows is he's carrying these big, thick printouts out every day. So he must be working his butt off, you know? It's going to be a long time before they trust most workers not to basically be under the eye. And in fact, for most jobs, I mean, you saw the growth in management, whatever. For most people's jobs, you're being monitored more than ever, constantly. And the growth on the other side of the jobs, the low-paying ones, those are the jobs machines can't do because no one wants a machine to walk out and set the plate in front of them.
So one of the things they hammer at you in future studies school is that the tendency is to overestimate the change in the short term, underestimate the long term. Right? Overestimate, oversell in the beginning, underestimate long term. People love being around other people. And I think that if you survey the most active people on, you know, Twitter in these environments, these are people that, despite thinking that they're online all the time, are the most social individuals in the world. These are individuals that love being around other people, that are creative and inspiring. Absolutely, companies want individuals next to them. I think people will work more days from home, more hours from home, or in co-working spaces or whatever, but absolutely work is going to remain a face-to-face-oriented reality for a very long time. I don't think we'll ever move away from that. Yeah, I don't think it's dehumanizing in any way. I think it's sharing ideas that lead to personal growth. You're all here because you received an email, right?
More questions?
Yeah.
Just one more follow-up on that. It's important to remember, and economists and futurists are always wrong, and we have a terrible track record. One of the first forecasts for the internet was that it would destroy cities, that there would be no need for cities because you could work from anywhere, and why would you choose to work from Manhattan? And yet, in fact, people like to cluster, and people benefit from clustering, and industries cluster.
And restaurants explode.
Right here, this woman right here in the gray sweater, sure.
Actually, I was, that's all right. I have a sort of a practical question. I opened up my own shingle in a professional world recently, sort of solo practice, and I thought I had pretty sophisticated social presence, as they say, social media presence, but boy, was I wrong. I'm realizing I need to retool my presence there. And my question is, there's been a virtual cottage industry of people advising you on that. But your message seems to be that you're willing to embrace that yourself in some measure. Where do you strike a balance? I mean,
it's like speaking to a coach earlier, and you know, do you work out on your own or do you need a personal trainer? If you feel like you can do it and get it done, you just get it done. You read the techniques, the best practices, you get it done. If you're someone that you like guidance, you like having someone give you expertise, engage those individuals, because I think as Jim mentioned, we're not exactly sure what social media people do, but we know that they're getting a little bit better at it. So if you're looking to retool your online presence, both of those pathways are viable. It's much more about your own personal kind of tendencies.
Next question, this woman right here.
Thank you. Hi, for both speakers. As an HR professional, I've been hearing about the war for talent for a few years now. And your graph reminded me, you know, once all those the baby boomers retire, what exactly is going to happen with the workforce? Will we have enough people to do the work?
People? Sure. I mean, no, seriously, it's not a numbers question. The maybe 60% of the adult population is working. I mean, we could turn around tomorrow and add 30 million people to the workforce if we gave them a good reason to want to get out there and paid them enough money to do it. So we don't have a people shortage. We have maybe a skills mismatch. And we have a, especially in slower economies, we have a, well, yeah, I want someone who can do that, but I ain't paying them that. Believe me, offer $50 an hour and see who shows up.
Yes, this right here.
Jim, you said anytime you hire based upon race, you're making an economically poor decision.
Well, actually, my point was if you're choosing based other than on work-related criteria, you are making a less than optimal choice. I mean, in economics, you should choose the person who can do the job the best. If when they walk in the door, you look at them and say, oh, that's a fat, bald, bearded guy. I don't like fat, bald, bearded guys. You know? Now, you know nothing about what I can do. You've just written me off.
Thank you.
And so maybe I'm the best person for the job.
My question, though. Is having to do with all the data and computerization that's going on. Do you see an improvement or a use for people who may not be the norm for what's walking in the door and what's considered to be acceptable? Because we know that people of color have a much higher unemployment rate than those who are not. So we're looking at the future now. So what happens to those people? Does it get worse?
It's not getting worse. By and large, relative employment is improving for groups that have traditionally have had problems. I mean, we've had a real shift, especially for women, and we've had some shift for minorities. But tech is sort of a neutral on that. In theory, yes, you can work from home, and it doesn't matter what you look like. They're somewhat reluctant to let people work from home. And the reality is tech lets them find out a lot about you without having to actually ever look you in the face. So maybe they'll decide they don't like you based on some externality. You'll never even know they evaluated you.
I think my comment there would just be what we need to be pushing for is a wholesale revolution in how we think about learning and education. And it is not fixing schools. It has nothing to do with teachers, and I love teachers. It has nothing to do with fixing schools or high-stakes testing or anything. It's about creating a culture of the learner, individuals that are self-aware, self-directed, and know how to access the tools to build the skills step by step to get to where they want to get. Now, technology in education has been a complete disaster in terms of mismanaged expectations. Technology in the early days was going to change, you know, schools and everyone's going to be homeschool, right? The technologies have not been very good, and they're a very bad fit for school environments because of all the other politics that layer on top. Learner-based technologies that are outside of schools are now popping up in MOOCs. You know, you can get a degree from MIT or Harvard or Stanford, and you don't have to go there, right? You can get a science degree from Brian Greene and the World Science, you know, Foundation. So I think the learner culture is what we need to invest in.
Okay, I think we have just time for one more question, right? So right here, and then there'll be time to speak with the speakers afterwards, I believe.
Hi, so I'm curious if there's any kind of initiatives that bring government together with say, someone like you from FutureThink and academia to think about ways to actually create opportunities? I mean, because it seems like there's a lot that the government could do. You have a lot of data and information on where things are going. And, you know, there's a lag in terms of I guess, academia or universities preparing students for the reality of the job market. And, you know, I know things have popped up like General Assembly and so forth that are retraining people who have lost their jobs for what the market needs are.
So I think it's more personal relationships that exist today, less formal structures. I think it's worth noting that New York City is becoming a magnet for data science, which you might put in the computer. You know, data science, the quants that all got laid off in Wall Street or they just walked away. Then they went to work for companies like Newton, which is an adaptive learning platform that is, you know, it's like Watson. It's a game changer. The talent that exists in New York City right now in terms of people that are developing tools to change learning, to change government, to change community building, the sharing economy, right? Airbnb, those types of things. They are strong in New York City. I don't think that the infrastructure to bring the right people together has been formalized just yet, but I think it will happen. So.
Okay, I'd like to thank our two speakers. I think it's been a wonderful presentation. Please join me in thanking them.